Hello, Sphere. I'm Daniel Medalitso Phiri, and I'll be talking to you today about why you should go headless. Before we get into that, let me tell you a little bit more about myself. So, like I said, I'm Daniel Medalitso Phiri. You can find me anywhere online as Malgambes. I usually am very active on Twitter here and there, so if that's the type of thing you like, you can catch me there. I do developer relations at Strapi, like I mentioned, and I'm a disc jockey and Mixcloud. So if you love techno or drum and bass, you'd love some of the stuff I put out. Right, now that that's done, let's talk about why you should go headless. The agenda for today will be looking at what headless is, for starters, just in case no one has an idea what that is. And then we'll go into why exactly you should go headless. I'll give you a couple of reasons why you should. And then, just because I think it's fair, we'll get into why you maybe shouldn't go headless. And there are a couple of good reasons there too. And then we'll look at what you should do if you do go headless. And then I'll be done with this hopefully fantastic talk. Right, let's get started with what is headless. So for those who aren't aware of what headless means, headless is really the short form of headless content management systems. A lot of people just call it like headless because there's headless commerce and other stuff like that. But when we talk about headless, what we mean is delivering content to any front end via an API. So you have content at the center of things, and then via your API, you can deliver to multiple platforms and to each of their front ends. So you could send something to a mobile device, you can send something to a desktop, a laptop, a smartwatch, and that's how headless works. There's many benefits to this approach, and that's what I'll get exactly into when I'm trying to convince all of you to go headless. So content is a big part of many businesses, it's a big part of many organizations. And traditionally we had what they call traditional CMSs, where your back office and your front office were tightly coupled. Headless sort of gets the head off, literally, it's headless. And it separates the back office where you manage your content from the front office where you generate web pages. And what this means is we can deliver to any platform, like I talked about, but traditionally the two are coupled. And then you can send to a web page, but you can't really send to a mobile device easily or a smartwatch. And it's really different now with the way we build. We don't really build websites the way we used to a couple years ago with a lot of traditional CMSs like WordPress or Drupal. Things have changed now. We've a vast array. I think developers are spoiled for choice when it comes to front-end frameworks. So the way we send content to these front-end frameworks changes, and the best at the moment being headless. It might change, it might not. The future will tell. But what headless does is it separates the back office and then gives you an API. And then using that API, you can then send data to multiple platforms, and you can serve or use your favorite front-end framework. As shown below, everyone's happy. Really good architecture. So that's what headless is in a nutshell. So now that we have a proper or basic understanding of what headless is, let's talk about why you should actually go headless. So there's many reasons why different people go headless. Let's start with an overview of these reasons. Excuse me. So developer flexibility, which I already touched on, is a big one. A secure business or content solution, a future-proof stack, custom content experiences, and team velocity. All very big reasons to go headless. Let's get into each and every one of these with a bit more detail. So when we talk about developer flexibility, we've talked about leaving the choice to developers or letting developers use exactly what they like. Today, particularly for JavaScript, and this extends to numerous static sites, there's so many frameworks, there's so many tools you can build to generate web pages, for example. And why have to settle for a coupled system when you could have the choice of frameworks like Gatsby, React, Next, Vue, or Nuxt.js? And all that is up to you. And this is a really huge advantage, because for some developers, they don't like being strong-armed into using something that they aren't comfortable with, or that they would have to learn when they already, if they could ship something similar with something they already know. So that flexibility is really big for a lot of people. And then you also have a secure content solution. A big problem with traditional CMSs was the fact that they were vulnerable to a lot of security threats. What this does when you go headless, because you sort of decouple the CMS from the front-end application, there are more attacks, or there are more entities to attack, which increases the complexity of such attacks and makes it much harder to sort of crack your system with a targeted attack. So there's less potential for that because there are way more targets. And because of this, a lot of people have and are moving to headless because it's a much more secure architecture. And then there's also the point of future-proofing your stack, making sure that changes in trends, changes in preferences don't really affect how you build or how your business functions. I like this excerpt that I got, and this is using WordPress as an example. This is using WordPress as an example. 38% of the web runs on WordPress, and in the 2020 Stack Overflow developer survey, 67% of developers said they did not want to continue developing with it. And it was the most dreaded technology. So something like WordPress, or let's not dunk on WordPress, let's say traditional CMSs, or anything that's currently being used, eventually wanes out. But with headless, because your front end isn't coupled tightly to your back end, you have the freedom to choose how you want to architect or how you want to structure your tech stack. And you have the flexibility to change it, going back into developer flexibility. This is just a chart of search trends. And this is WordPress as an example, like I mentioned, but this is really true for most technologies. Switching to something or switching to a headless architecture really lets you make decisions for the future, because you can simply take out that front end and replace it with the next best thing when you need to. So you don't necessarily find yourself in a situation where you have outdated tech, or you find it really hard to upgrade. And that's a huge benefit of headless too. And then there's custom experiences. I gave a talk at the Headless Commerce Summit that talks about how CMSs can be used to enable custom experiences. These go way beyond just headless commerce. We had our first user conference at Strapi, and we used Strapi to create a quiz to extend the conference experience for attendees. If you'd like some resources on my headless commerce talk, you can go to this link, bit.ly/strapi-hcom, and you have resources on how to approach headless commerce and build custom experiences with a CMS like Strapi. And then there's also the aspect of team velocity. Structuring your content strategy around workflows that are enabled by a CMS is a really, really good bet. What we're doing here is creating workflows that make teams as efficient as possible. And then we're going to every single team here. I have a sample workflow that I've been sharing at past conferences that I've been speaking about, which involves building modular modern applications. So you see there's communication between the developer team and the content team, who adds content to your CMS, and then the developer team who creates your application. And centering or having an architecture where you have adopted headless really makes for more efficient workflows because you don't always have to have back and forth changes. Should the content team want more content on the website, the development team doesn't always have to build it. And I think this is something that a lot of people, particularly in enterprise circles, would really benefit for. So if this is something you're interested in, again, I have resources here at bit.ly/strapidzone. You can have a look at these resources, and that would be very helpful for forming your own workflows around headless architecture. And then we get to look at why you maybe shouldn't switch to headless. Very, very important also. Let's have an overview. There aren't that many reasons that I'm presenting to you, to be honest. I'm not just saying that because I work for a headless CMS company. There's a lot that goes into going headless, and I think these two things are really important. If you have a small team, you probably shouldn't go headless. And if you have only simple publishing needs, then you probably shouldn't go headless either. And these two are related, and I'll explain how. So if you have a small team, it takes quite some, it going or adopting headless is resource intensive, in that you need to have a dedicated development team to build out your front end, because it isn't like one of the traditional CMSs where you get an all-in-one package and you can just start adding content to your website. You actually have to design and build a website and then add content to the website. So it takes a lot to get up and running with headless architectures in general. Another thing that you want or that would limit you, given that you have a small team, is previews. With most traditional CMSs, once you put in content, you have a preview of what that content will look like on your front end, on your web page. And to do this with a headless tool or a headless content management system takes a fair amount of effort from the developers. And given you have a small team, this isn't something that would be as intuitive or done efficiently or as fast as you would love it. So it's definitely something I would suggest avoiding. The second reason is, if you have simple publishing needs, you probably shouldn't go headless, because headless has a lot of really cool features, or a lot of these headless tools have a lot of really cool features, like I said, that enable different workflows. But if you just want to put out blog posts, or you don't have that many blog posts, or you don't have that much content that you need to keep constantly publishing and publishing, then you probably shouldn't go headless, because then the effort isn't worth it. And as you grow, as your team grows, as your company grows, as your publication schedule or your publication cadence changes, then maybe you can start to contemplate adopting a headless architecture. Right. These are the only reasons I had to give you. Now let's look at what you should do if you do go headless. So, if you do go headless, very selfish plug here, I would really highly suggest you use something like Strapi, and I'll tell you why. Strapi is a headless CMS, so if you go headless, of course you'd want to have a headless CMS. It's open source and an MIT license, so its source code is available on GitHub. It has a ton of contributors, so you know it's not just gonna die tomorrow. It's customizable via plugins, via concepts like controllers or policies. It is also self-hosted, so if that's something that's very important, if you're in a very sensitive vertical or field, this is something that really matters for you: banking, healthcare, finance. You want a self-hosted solution, so you have ownership of your data. It's 100% JavaScript built with Node.js. And it has a really robust plugin system, which we are making even better with upcoming releases. We have a big version 4 release coming up, and that will make creating, using, and sharing plugins much, much easier. And a fan favorite, we have and support GraphQL. So if REST isn't enough for you, we have GraphQL. We've seen people add and use both REST and GraphQL together, or just use GraphQL alone. But if you need it, we've got it. And I think that, let me just go back. I think these alone are like reason enough for you to want to use something like Strapi. And these are just the developer-centric features. We have a lot more publication or content manager-based features, which I won't necessarily get into, but I'll leave you with resources so you can find out how best to take advantage of them. If you'd like to get started with Strapi today, right now, in your terminal, all you have to do is run yarn create Strapi app, and then give your project a name, and then done. You have a brand new Strapi app, which you can play around with, content, structure some models, and yeah, basically just see where that takes you. And let me know how your headless journey goes. Right, so here are some resources. If you go to strapi.io/starters, you have ready-made starters, so you can get started with building on Strapi and on top of Strapi. Starters are like full stack applications, so it's a pre-built front end, pre-modeled Strapi back end. You put them together and they work like a charm. If that's not something you're interested in, you can go to strapi.io/resource center, and we have a bunch of really cool resources to help you find out anything that you'd love to know about Strapi. So, thank you so much. It's been Daniel Medalitso Phiri. And if you have any questions, you can reach out to me on Twitter. And I look forward to hearing your questions, comments, and feedback. Thank you so much. Have a great day, everyone.